make you want to get up and shake a little tail feather a little bit.
It's the 90s, Hacksaw! Get on board!
So you people think I ain't serious, you better take a look at me again.
Let the party begin. I've got snacks.
Well, hello. Look at us. We did it. Another Tuesday night. We did it another week. It was in 8 days. We were here last Monday because of the big American kaboom holiday. Proud of you all for getting here. This is WCW Deep Cuts Live every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern. You and I get together. And we watch some wrestling from like 25 to 30 years ago that likely a lot of folks didn't watch when it was live. But we're watching it now. We're spending our time together, blowing off some steam from the world, and we're doing it. I see a lot of really cool folks in the chat. Brian Dermody, of course. LJH, Brinticus Maximus, Adam4836, Classic Wrestling Review. Jonathan Mayer, Pep is in the chat. Who else? Let me scroll through. Very lively chat already this evening. Why is it? Baron Von Rashi, one of my favorite internet usernames. Soggy Hydrox. Don't worry if you're sleepy. We will all take a nap together. Some of us just will be there later than others. So, welcome. This week, we are watching WCW Saturday Night from July 1998. It's like right here on the peak. We're going up. And about a couple weeks after this, we start going down. In the trajectory of World Championship Wrestling in the popular American zeitgeist. So we're going to have a lot of fun tonight. Congrats, Jonathan, for breaking his wife's AEW Fight Forever win streak. Thank you, Nathan, for subscribing with Prime and bringing up the gambler in the corner there. Great appearance on Talk is Jericho this week, if you've not listened yet. Seems like a really sweet, nice guy. And his son, really sweet dude on Twitter. So let's get going with the first episode. A click.
Scott, we are on the eve of one of the most.
And you cannot start off an episode of 1998 American Wrestling Television better than with Toriyama on students. We got Judo Suwa, and we got Don Fuji, who is Sumo Fuji at this point. Where his, what's the name of the Japanese, the Sumo? It's not the Ushigiroshi. The Ushigiroshi is the suplex. I forget the name. But nonetheless, we got Sumo Fuji, aka Don Fuji, and Judo Suwa in the ring. Mawashi, thank you, Classic Wrestling Review. We're in a Mawashi over a singlet. They're facing Public Enemy, you know? Because, of course, when you bring in Ultimo Dragon students from Mexico via Japan, you would put them against Public Enemy.
The world heavyweight champion defeating Hollywood Hogan in that classic.
I believe it is Mawashi, I'm pretty sure.
On their feet, chanting Goldberg.
Yeah, the gambler was great on Talk of Jericho last week. He seems like such a sweet, nice old man. He just, he's so happy about his time in wrestling. And then when it was done, it was done.
Absolutely off the charts.
And
everyone that I've
washed his hands of it. Wasn't
event,
mad. Wasn't upset.
To remember so many things.
He had his run. He had 9 years in WCW. Getting paid consistently. And he realized it was a good time. And then he went
on. And then that big payoff when Goldberg defeated Hollywood Hogan. Everyone that I have spoken with talks about their ears still ringing.
Public Enemy come along great. In the WCW locker room, all their drinking buddies were there. At least Johnny's drinking buddies were. I told the story in here a few weeks ago. Around the time of when we watched that German pay-per-view a couple weeks ago, Johnny Grunge and Hugh Morris got a DUI for stealing the ring truck drunk at Disney World. That was a double entendre. Johnny Grunge hammering and somebody else.
Sua and Fuji roll out to the floor, an opportunity for them to regroup.
Yeah, man, WCW,
as of late,
you know, you were either there for like 3 months or you were there for a decade.
They're doing everything they can.
Nobody spent like a year. Nobody just had like one contract. Either you got fired after your 90 days or you were tenured. Look at Sumo Don Fuji go. There's a match we gotta watch on here at some point. It was these two against the Faces of Fear, where Don Fuji actually got the Barbarian to do the sumo standoff with him. And it was really funny.
Look at that, Public Enemy has to be labeled.
Warrior was only there for about 90 days. He was in August. He was gone by November. So yeah, he essentially was a 90-day contract cycle. I don't know. Supposed to be longer, but didn't work out for him.
And Judo Suwa and Sumo Fuji know if they listen to Dragon, they're going to go places. But right now, all they can hear are the chops from Flyboy Rocco Rock across the chest of Judo Suwa.
That Rocco Rock has mostly given up on the idea of looking. That was cool. Giving up and trying to look like a quote unquote thug. He just kind of ties a bandana around, otherwise, he's just Ted Petty.
Really.
I did see that picture of Haku's giant grandson. That's scary. Oh, geez. Yeah, Haku's grandson, if you've not seen him, I think Chris Zellner posted the picture on Twitter the other day. Haku's got an 11-year-old grandson who's already taller than he is, and like as wide as a fridge. Just a giant.
They continue the double team tactics. Looks like we're going to see the drive by.
Hello,
ooh.
Good night.
Hello, Suzanne. Well,
welcome.
Look at this. We are furthering a feud on Saturday night.
Opening up on the Public Enemy. What in the world?
The tongue and fridge.
Look at Alex Wright with the boots to Flyboy Rocco Rock. Meanwhile, on the opposite side of the ring, the same thing is happening as Disco Inferno.
It's the Dancing Fools, which if you saw little social media bits I put together to promote this, definitely won't be the last time we see the Dancing Fools.
Public Enemy, they certainly won the battle, but as this matchup evolves, it turns out that they're going to lose the war.
What cheap shot artist?
Going down a Berlin rabbit hole sounds like something new. Ask a sex worker to do for you when you're real lonely.
Saturday night.
But
WCW and NWO present Bash at the Beach. Diamond,
I'm just
Dallas
glad
Page,
these Bash at the Beach promos are not as depressing as they take on the last one. Where it's all like doomy and gloomy and like rainstormy.
Tomorrow night on pay-per-view, Bash at the Beach, 98. Welcome back to WCW Saturday Night. I'm Scott.
Mike Tenay, who probably said something real filthier before they went live. Look at that smirk on his face.
And Horace representing the
Wade Boggs' favorite stable, the Flock, against Perry Saturn and Van Hammer.
That is still to come, but let's not forget, we've got a new man at the top.
Merlin Rattles, the German of Goldberg. Their club. This is why you got to get in the chat if you're watching and you're not in the chat. as we're only getting like half of it. We're just watching this. We can watch this anywhere. The chance will make
what
it
a
fun.
Way to kick it off this past Monday at Nitro.
And yeah, I imagine that. I would imagine the Disco Inferno commentary in the year 2000 is pretty bad.
To witness what, in my mind, was a chance for the balance of power to switch dramatically to World Championship Wrestling. The United States Heavyweight Champion, number one contender to the world's heavyweight title, Goldberg representing WCW. And Scott,
I feel like this is the same shirt Mike Tenay wore when we were watching 98 WCW a while back.
The United Front that is WCW.
Like, it'd be funny if, like, Page and Malone, Hogan and secretly we find out someday that they actually did book out, like, WCW like a year in advance. But the only way you knew is that they just taped all the Saturday Night two shots with the announcers, like, a year in advance. But that's the only, thing. Like, they're the only two that knew what's going on. Here comes Lenny Lane. This is an example of a gimmick where he just brought something to the TV show. He's like, I'm gonna do it. I love salmon.
If you win, you get to finish the job, and you started last Thursday.
Any recommendations for Salmon's next autobiography to read? Wrestling wise,
those beautiful brown locks falling to the ground, Eddie. Let me know. Can you handle it? Let me know, Eddie. Call me.
Straight from the horse's mouth. It's a body oil.
Eddie Guerrero now. Eddie has accepted the challenge. It's tomorrow night at Bash at the Beach. Hair versus hair. This man, Chavo Guerrero Jr.,
because I'm not much of a reader, not a smart person.
And he will be able.
And here comes Chavo Guerrero. You cannot cut a man's hair if he is wearing a hard hat.
The winner of this match is able to cut the hair.
Harry Funk's book was all right.
Now, if I remember back,
I love the anecdote about him meeting the ICP and then being scared and being like, I'm going to kick their asses. I'm going to get that money for the Stranglemania tape where they made fun of King of the Deathmatch. And then, like, they slipped him thousands of dollars.
That was Eddie Guerrero. And
the Nitro book is really good.
Eddie Guerrero came out of that one.
One of the best researched wrestling books.
Eddie, I can sympathize. I know why you're worried, brother.
Regal's book is great.
You may lose all of those gorgeous locks at Bash at the Beach. And Mike, I understand we may have some ticket information.
Yes, Chavo is wrestling in the hard hat because he has a match coming up, a hair match with Eddie Guerrero. So he's going to keep the hard hat on his head at all times.
We advise you to check with the Aztec box office and Ticketmaster in the San Diego area. Now listen up.
Hello, number one gunkle.
In Wisconsin, Indiana, and Illinois.
Yes, Lenny Lane was very much like. He was like the number two heel for like.
Major events will be going on.
Like not the top territory, but like one of like the middle ones.
The date will be Saturday, August the 22nd. Tickets at the Brown County Expo Center box office and all Ticketstar locations.
Hello. Drugs Delaney, welcome. I love that. Landed the dropkick. I love when a dude lands a dropkick and then lands on top of the opponent to like do a print. And we got purple Nurple. Purple Nurple.
Plus, you can meet the Nitro girls at the Civic Center box office. Next Friday.
Only 13 minutes into this stream, we got a purple Nurple.
Chavo Guerrero Jr. was a very unorthodox.
Eric is doing much better.
And
happy to report, making some progress in terms of finding those punks who took his bike and beat him up. But a lot of people have come in with a lot of love for him the last couple days. He's got two bikes now. So he's doing all right. So thank you for checking in on me, Drugs.
Corner to corner.
Don't you ever use.
Lenny Lane, to a point, I could see him being, yeah, kind of 91 babyface Shane Douglas. I could see that. That's funny, Brian, you mentioned that. The reason why he was so dull, Shane, which I'm not, he was dull, but they were building up to him releasing a single and doing a mall tour like Tiffany. I swear to you, that was the plan for him in the WWF. And then Shane was like, I'm going to bow out. I'm good. Thank you. But yeah, that was the plan. Was Shane was going to come in, get a couple wins, get his face seen, and then like record a single. And they were going to try to get it on the radio.
caught the elbow right in the face.
Wear hand to whatever religious scripture you want me to put it on.
It's
like Shane. I've seen heard Shane talk about it. I think Bruce Pritchard talked about it once. I think I even heard Pat Patterson. I think he even heard talk about it once. Apparently Shane can sing. He just refuses to do so in public, and that was the big like. He didn't want to be a circus act. He didn't want to redo the Dynamic Dudes thing. But yeah, he was supposed to be a teen idol heartthrob, teeny bopper singer. Balls Mahoney said a lot of things. Balls Mahoney once claimed to have killed a shark with a spork.
Just neutralizing Lenny Lane, not wasting any time, grabs the hair. Lenny Lane's going to shoot him off into the rest. Chavo maintains contact, maintains his grip.
I like the 91 Rumble. I think it gets a bit of a bad rap as a show, but it's got that Orient Express Rockers match, the opener. Arguably one of the best tag matches in, like, WWF history. Definitely 90s history. Oh my gosh, right butthole right in the turnbuckle. It's got Boss Man against Barbarian that's really good. And I even like the Rumble. I think that's a good show.
Distracted. We talked earlier about Chavo. Eddie Guerrero has been on something of a losing streak of late in World Championship Wrestling, and I love, gotta think it's
you can tell we're deep in the Attitude Era because dudes just are not just ignoring the ref. Like Chavo's just like, I'm just gonna grab his hair. Just pull him up by the hair. I like 93 too. I like the 93 Rumble too. I like the Steiners and the Beverlys. I think the Rumble match is alright. Brett and Razor is pretty good. And yes, Cleopatra and Julius Caesar. You have not shared your just incredible story with us, Brooks. I'm assuming it's something like your Jesse Camp story.
Good call, Lenny. Oh, there goes our official referee, Mark Curtis.
And Mark Curtis on this better rope. Mark Curtis of WCW Revenge fan.
Oh, he's lost it.
WCW and NWO present Bash at the Beach on pay-per-view tomorrow night. From NWO Hollywood, Kurt Hennig squares off against the new heavyweight champion of the world, Goldberg, tomorrow night at Bash at the Beach.
But Villa is back and has made his presence felt.
You have no choice but to love me, right?
Dennis Rodman.
I'm coming after Dennis the Worm Rodman.
Diamond Dallas Page.
And Hollywood
Scum Hogan. I don't necessarily get flashbacks to Sid and Arn when anybody uses scissors in wrestling, but I when they did that like acclaimed like celebration party like a few months back when they won the belts, I really thought they should have done like a little like Easter egg for those of us old people that remember Sloan and Sid and done a thing where Sid and Arn scissored like in the locker room while everybody's scissoring out in the arena. I thought that would have been cute.
And Bash at the Beach, they shall swim with the fishes.
Or will Malone and DDP taste revenge?
You will.
We never saw a DDP Hogan one-on-one pay-per-view match because somebody would have had to lose. I mean, DDP sure would have, but he also would have probably been Eric. Kim's coming over, but really don't want to lose to Terry. Bye, brother.
Attention WCW Hotline fans. My broadcast colleague, Mean Gene Okerlund, has prepared
this
a hard-hitting and
Gene couldn't be bothered to do his own
that you can't
thoughts.
Afford to miss. And it's available now along with all the latest news
from
inside
this probably,
the world of pro
this looks like it was
so pick up the phone
like
and call 1-900-909-9900.
Gene's like, I don't want to go to the tower this week. You do my thing, Mike.
Before calling, but don't forget to call the hotline. And don't forget to check out WCWWrestling.com.
Thanks a lot, Mike.
Maybe just throw that in at the end. Oh, and we have a website, too. Brought to you by Burger King.
Burger King, if you ask us, it just tastes better.
comedy in the crowd with a stop sign as we see Johnny Swinger dressed like a sexy big potato.
We have three championship matchups scheduled. It's going to be Goldberg defending the
world. Who would have thunk this is one of the guys on the show who's still working 25 years later on TV?
He's finally going to get Kurt Hennig in the ring.
Goldberg and brother Hennig have been running.
I love the person that went to a print shop. It's like, hey, I'm going to wrestling. Could you print me, like, the logo of the company and then, like, rocks on it? And I'll pay you, I'm assuming that costs, like, $75 at the time.
For Hollywood Hogan, you're not thinking. Kurt Hennig wants revenge. He wants
He's facing Ernest the Cat Miller back when he was still coming out to that Muzak version of the Zoom. See, if you come out to the Zoo, you better be throwing dudes over the top here.
What the NWO Black and White?
All right, I don't want to see.
What those members have up their sleeves? Johnny Swinger has the mic.
What now?
Do you know who I am? Nobody cares who you are.
Whoa! There's your answer, Johnny. I don't think
why
the cat knows who you
just
are.
Letting dudes cut promos?
Johnny Swinger's angry now, opening up on the cat, Ernest Miller.
Like, what?
Scott, also tomorrow at Bash at the Beach, the world's television title is going to
like,
be
imagine
on
watching, like, main event, and Dana Brooke grabs the mic. She's just like, here's my catchphrase now.
And I think we both agree this is going to be the stiffest test yet in singles competition for Booker T defending that TV championship belt against the Hitman.
Well, Booker T went to the best of eight with Chris Benoit before winning the television title from Fitz Finlay. Those are two of the toughest questions you're ever going to meet.
Swinger was fun in ECW, or yeah, in ECW. I don't know why I thought ECW was in ECW. But, I think for WWE, he was too short. He's not a tall guy. He's like well under 6 feet. Like, he's like a built dude. But, like, I think he's the same height, if not shorter, than Rhino.
Will be in action at Bash at the Beach in a matchup against Chavo Guerrero Jr. So Chavo Jr. going to be doing double duty because he has the challenge
Miller
match against
gym
Stevie
shorts.
Ray. In addition
just
to the hair
fancy
match
gym
against
shorts
Uncle Eddie.
To the ring.
I think Chavo Guerrero Jr. has one match for each personality he's got, and that's two tomorrow night at Bash at the Beach. One
come other on, Scott Hudson. Chavo had more than two personalities.
Chris Jericho to defend
if we're going
to
make fun of Did, then let's really do it the ring. That was a cravat Russian leg spin. That was the Whiplash 2000. Thank you for that match. Johnny Swinger just like casually doing it.
He's rude, he's offensive, and he's just
he's immense.
What does that even mean? But he is a talented wrestler and a fighting cruiserweight champion. He will defend the title tomorrow night. But just because Jericho
because in ECW, everybody had a move name that rhymed with their name or their gimmick.
Well, a part, I guess,
or if you're Danny Doring, literally every movement
sports.
You made
the that Chris
was
Jericho
a different
has taken, the total disrespect for Dean Malenko and his entire family as we see the roll up by the cat for a two count on Johnny Swinger. This is just absolutely over the edge as far as what Chris Jericho has done to Malenko and disrespected his entire family.
Well, I don't blame Dean Malenko at all. Dean Malenko defended the honor of his father. Of
go back
his
and watch a Danny Doring match when he's getting pushed from ECW. The commentary is miserable.
Under the penalty of losing his
Miss Joey Styles is like, boogie Dean bang, bang right bear back, wham bam, thank you ma'am. Sex
now,
pun, another sex pun.
Going in this matchup with Johnny Swinger. And Swinger continues
Diamond and Swinger once like yeah, and, like I like them better in TNA than I like them in ECW because they chilled out on maybe they were like a team and not haha we're clowns and they were everywhere all right in ECW
with the big boys,
but I thought their run with AMW
you
was better than their run in ECW.
He is the hottest young commodity in World Championship Wrestling if you ask him.
Yeah, if we listen to him every time he grabs the microphone.
Also, I'm a big fan of guys who tape their fists.
Who don't
throw punches?
Press clippings.
He's be
like,
the young
like all the old timers, like, why do you wear kick pads but you don't throw kicks? That's
time,
fine, whatever. But he, this is what boxers do.
That's the opportunity the cat has been waiting for. Chance to recover now.
Oh, geez. Wow, Ernest Miller. Oh, shit, he almost killed him. That's probably why he never did another one of those. Because he tested it out on Johnny Swinger. Oh God, please tell me that's his finish. That would be so funny.
Now applied by the cat.
Wow.
Look at him. What a hot comeback.
I'm gonna kill you with the press slam, and then snap more hammerlock.
Antagonize someone like the cat with all of that gaga about you being the hottest commodity, etc., etc.
Everybody else is like, punch, backdrop, hip hop, Ernest Miller, Snapmare,
Swinger now, hang on, opening up on the cat, putting the boots to the big
kill. I'm assuming the reason why things didn't work out in WWE was because they actually saw him in a TV, because he was under contract for a bit. Feliner, I love that kick. Because, like, when you're not standing next to him, it's like, oh, shit, this guy's pretty big. And then you stand next to him, oh, he's like 5'10". Like, I think it was Bruce Pritchard who admitted he tried to push Roadkill versus The Undertaker at WrestleMania.
The eventual three count, and the cat gets an impressive win on Saturday night.
Dude, I would put money on 18-year-old drugs beating the shit out of Roadkill. That is
enjoy
badass.
The crystal blue waters. Relax in the warmth of the sun.
See, this is more like undiscovered there. This is a Bash at the Beach commercial.
Skinny dip with a shark.
Now this is paradise.
Why is the WCW pit crew fucking with these people?
Somebody's going down.
WCW Wait. NWO Bash at the Beach.
The jumpers just like swimming in the ocean, fucking beating people up. That was Del Torborg. Del Torborg and Chad Fortune, the pit crew.
Saturday night in Mike Tenay, it was at the Georgia Dome in Atlanta, 41,000 strong. The number one contender, Goldberg, got his shot at the gold of Hollywood Hogan.
Scott, in 1998, if you were to arrange the wrestling organizations
sorry to hear that, drugs.
Order, I think the consensus hopefully opinion with would be that world championship
98
wrestling
Twitter alternatives opening
three.
Up everybody's fragments to different places
NWO
in the year.
Black and white led
all
by
not angry
Hogan,
as much NWO Wolf or we just get more angry and fight in like little groups
of Sting and Lex Luger. But this past Monday on Nitro,
this past Monday on Nitro, I made a little tent with my hands
to win the world
and then Goldberg won the world title. But
let's take a look at
my tent, my little hands tent. Look at
Hollywood Hogan stunned the world by today, said he was back out of the match with Goldberg.
Again, it kills me that this aired on free TV and they're like, no, we have to run stills.
That was the NWO brother that Hollywood Hogan talked about, and Scott Hall came to the ring, Goldberg bringing in the U.S. title.
Drugs, if you win the Powerball,
winning streak on the line.
Scott Hall gave Goldberg
$50
all he could handle,
would be nice.
But the U.S. champ was up to the challenge. The disciple and
Vincent
came
much.
In. Carl Malone and DDT made the save with the chair.
$50
And Goldberg won the match with, you know it, the jackhammer. He was ready for Hollywood Hogan.
Just
look at the anticipation in the face of Goldberg as he purposely strode to the ring. They
Hello,
locked it up
Sega.
In the early going. The strength advantage
Dude,
of Goldberg
if you pay off my house,
brought the steel chair into play.
I'll name this the Drugs Delaney.
He cuts line. The 1-2 punch.
I'll put a sign up in my house that says, like, whatever you want it to trust the ring is, like, incredible.
This Monday, live
Badass.
On TNT, you have the opportunity to relive history because we are going to show you...
Dude, that's right. There is the dude who threw the world toilet paper and hits Goldberg in, like, his big crowning moment. Someone, like... And they're going to air footage of it in the
This is going to be a Nitro that you don't want to miss. It's Goldberg versus Hogan. Watch it again Monday,
$600 million.
Live on TNT.
The Powerball. And I think that's just enough to pay for the WCW roster in 1998.
WCW and NWO present Bash at the Beach.
Kevin Green. Mean Green Kevin Green. I love him. Man.
Goes one-on-one
Colin,
with the largest
would have been,
athlete
he would have been
in the world, the giant
megastar.
NWO Hollywood. It's tomorrow night. WCW and NWO present Bash at the Beach.
Hollywood Hulk Hogan to defend the WCW heavyweight against Goldberg.
Hogan retaliated with an obstacle for Goldberg.
Are you kidding?
NWO brother, he's gonna give Goldberg his first loss tonight.
So they aired stills in the last set.
Just in case Goldberg.
But now they're gonna air the video.
And get by this NWO brother. Then and only then will I grace you.
Like, I understand, like, a Nitro things being crazy.
Team WCW show their support.
We have an answer.
Are they like just having different people write every segment of the taped show?
Power laid in Goldberg's hands.
Dude, Goldberg's like WWE pay-per-view title run is ridiculous. This show, he was in like the mid-card in a tag match. Road Wild, he was in a battle royal that was like second from the top. Wasn't even on Fall Brawl. Halloween Havoc, he had the world title match, but didn't even air in like a lot of households because it went so late. And then Starcade, obviously, lost to Kevin Nash. So yeah, Goldberg's world title random pay-per-view. Didn't even make a noise. Kevin Green really, yeah, if WCW would have stayed open, I feel like Kevin Green would have at least tried for a year or so. I don't know if it would have, because he was hurt by that point, I guess. So I don't know if it would have went as well, but that would have been great. I never got Peacock through Xfinity because I don't have cable. But we watch other stuff on it. Like, I'll occasionally watch like old WWF Superstars episodes when I'm doing cardio. Despite what it looks like, I do like a shitload of cardio. I'm an elliptical guy. But I watch WWF Superstars on Peacock.
And have you ever wondered why you and your brother look absolutely nothing alike?
I'm elliptical.
That's enough.
So I have it. It's more of a issue of the pay-per-views being on at like 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Saturdays.
Dean Malenko's in. This match is thrown out. And Malenko doesn't give a darn. I never thought we would see this to a man.
Hello, stats.
Like Dean Malenko. What is that?
That camera angle.
Wow. I mean, it is so volatile between these two men. It's something that a wrestling ring, literally, it's an old cliche, but it really applies here.
That was amazing to just look up and see Dean Malenko, like, doing poop face into the camera.
It's main event time on WCW Saturday Night.
Yeah, the Peacock Superstars run is until, like, almost the end of the show. They're well into the era of Superstars where it's, like, just on the USA. I just watched the week after Jim Ross turned heel and brought in Razor and Diesel, and the commentary's so entertaining. They're just making fun of people that were at the Cauliflower Alley convention the night before. Like, I guess Jerry Briscoe at that thing said that he loved Vince McMahon, and so him and Kurt Hennig were just making fun of him.
Raven and Horace are in the ring with the clock.
This is the period where Horace was the number two guy in the Full Hog.
Because
Hogan was like, dude, my nephew's been under contract for like a year and a half. We'd do something with him. And Raven, being a smart politician, was like, give me Hogan's nephew. Here comes babyface heroin addict Van Hammer. All strung out with slapping hands. Tough,
Mike. And the breakup between Saturn and Raven was brutal. The breakup between Van Hammer and the rest of the flock was brutal.
Van Hammer's so funny.
Saturn and Van Hammer wrestled to see who would stay in the flock, and now they're both out.
And they're both happy to be out. And
no classic wrestling interview. They were all heroes. Like, I think it was like a recent Raven interview where he's like, yeah, they were all supposed to be on heroin. No, like, that was the gimmick, because I was giving them heroin, and they would follow me. Kidman was just the one that was like showing the signs. But yeah, they were all supposed to be heroin.
This Monday on Nitro, you will get a shot to relive the moment.
Wrestling Bios, heard they're going on a bit of a break. Hopefully he's doing it.
The new king of the hill, the top of the mountain, Goldberg, the new champ. Nothing beats a live Nitro, Mike.
Well, Scott, speaking of Nitro and big events,
hello, Bender. Welcome. We are watching heroin addicts wrestle each other. I assume not shoot heroin addicts, but who knows? I have no idea how Perry Saturn was able to do all those cool karate kicks with those tight jeans.
This upcoming Thursday, July the 16th, will be in Oakland, California. Tickets at the Arena box office and all fast ticket outlets.
Raven just draped Saturn across the top.
Hello, David Syracuse.
Boot to the face, takes Saturn down. And this is something of a Bash at the Beach tune-up, because tomorrow night, one-on-one, Raven and Saturn will go at it, hopefully to settle it all.
Charles Robinson in the era before,
well, there has been a long standing rivalry between these two.
You can dye your hair and be a reclaimer. Thank you for the bit, Steven Syracuse. Bringing up Van Hammer, ironically.
There's plenty of payback in store for Raven tomorrow.
Dude, Horace and Aces and Eights would have been so good. And I'm surprised it didn't happen. I'm surprised Hogan wasn't like, dude, Horace is ready for one more run, brother.
That's why not at all, man.
I'm surprised.
The leg sweep into the railing at ringside. That's why
Saturn's horse hasn't popped up at Hogan's barn.
By the enigmatic leader of the block.
I am too right. It's possible. I'm curious as to what horse Hogan is doing.
He's going to get a shot tomorrow night in San Diego.
Because you'd think he would have like popped up somewhere.
And if you listen to him tell the story, that bond goes back even further than Far Point.
Yeah, he should have been in
this. He has stories about how he and Saturn grew up as friends in school. The cover of the big splash. Horace gets a two count. Also tomorrow, it's going to be one on one. We thought it was
I'm very excited for Nick Wayne. As an old school FRW board member, listened to all of his dad's old podcasts back in the day. I'm very excited for Nick Wayne to be on TV.
Face to face with the giant tomorrow night at Bash at the Beach.
Kevin Green, imagine Horace Hogan running the grill at Hogan's barn. Like scraping shit up with that stop sign.
But tomorrow night,
showing up to work.
You are a terrific
with an apron
player,
and no shirt on underneath.
One of the best ever, inarguably, the Carolina Panthers are very lucky right, to have you back, but I don't know. You
haven't WWE signed Horace Hogan to a development deal.
Kevin, you
after
haven't
WCW
seen anything like the Giants. 7'4", 500-plus-pound cover
as
by
a,
Raven.
As a favorite of the Hulkster.
That's going to be a war tomorrow night, Kevin. I hope you're ready.
And the Giant has such a huge edge, not only in power, not only in size, but also
yeah,
in
experience.
Would
be like the
oh, yeah. No question about it. This is what? Kevin Green's third professional
Hogan's
wrestling
bar.
Match.
I saw recently.
Cannot wait for that one tomorrow night on pay-per-view.
Hulk is now doing a ventriloquist act at the Hulk Hogan barn. I saw a video of it. He is better at not moving his mouth than you'd think. I don't know if it's from calling spots or what, but he has a little orange puppet, and he does a bit with it. Glacier, I don't think he has a regular podcast, but Glacier did a podcast with Conrad for their Patreon.
7-year itch of Kidman.
I love Glacier. He seems like a nice middle-aged man. Again, I would never talk politics with him. But another one of those guys that seems like he got what he wanted out of wrestling.
Saturn is not moving very well at all. Hang on. Double underhook salto by Raven. Cover. Hooks the leg. Charles Robinson down. And got the
I love the Glacier. I did hear Glacier tell a story once that like, Bischoff called him like when they were putting together Blood Runs Cold. Bischoff called him up in the middle of the night. He's like, you need to get over to my house now. We have to go somewhere. And he gets in the Bischoff's like, Corvette or whatever. And they sped off. And they go to some parking garage somewhere. Bischoff is fucked up out of his mind on various substances. His eyes are bloodshot red and about this big. They pull him to the parking garage, and it's an underground fight. And Bischoff will not stop talking? He's talking a million miles a minute about how this is what Blood Rings Cold is going to be. It's a bunch of guys beating the shit out of each other in a garage. And then none of that ever happened. Bischoff just wanted somebody to go with him to watch the fucking blood sport in a parking garage.
If you will, he is a very, very talented wrestler. Let's not forget that. He knows what he is doing inside the rope. Horace, the big man, 300 pounds, going up top and drops.
I love that Horace Hogan, Hulk Hogan's nephew, is like, I need to start doing a top rope splash. That'll impress me. That's not a good one, but I'll start doing that.
Important at this point for him to get the fresh man, Van Hammer, in the ring.
Horace misses the clothesline. Saturn, the suplex.
Hopefully that didn't buffer for anybody else.
Saturn is fifth, there's the tag. Van Hammer, the tag to Raven, and here we go.
Oh, look at that. Look. Oh, jeez. Almost killed Raven, and Raven didn't even leave the ground. Okay. No buffering. I was worried it was a buffering issue on my end. Oh, jeez. What is Hammer going to do a dive? Oh, no. Okay. I love that. That's my new favorite guy. I'm gonna do one. I'm gonna do it. I'm over the rope. Gingerly.
We knew that chair was gonna backfire all right. Time. Drop kick, and it went face first. Raven caught all of that steel.
I'm pretty sure Horace and Mike Awesome teamed in FMW. But yeah, I love that guy. That's my new favorite guy.
Hang on. Look at Van Hammer. Van Hammer has Horace.
What the hell? Why are you doing this on Saturday night? Oh my god. Why? Perry Saturn, you're insane. And the table didn't really even break. It just kind of like fell. Right after Hammer does that bullshit dive, Saturn's like, you know what? I'm gonna break my ribs. Fuck me. This is Van Hammer's big break. And after all that, Raven's the wins. That's why Scotty is the smartest man in wrestling. Or at least was. Now he's in MLW.
And it's taken out of them tonight on Saturday night. What a gallant effort from Saturn and Van Hammer.
Van Hammer.
The numbers game, all the flock members that
I don't know. Like, that dude, before he got put in the flock, like the Christmas party before that, is that he got his ass beat at DDP's house by Steven Regal for saying that people that weren't from America shouldn't be in wrestling. And then he still got the flunk kick.
What a main event tag match on Saturday night.
WCW and NWO present Bash at the Beach. Diamond Dallas Page.
And there was a point in like 95 when he was like kind of quasi with them, but not really. He was on TV like once or twice that year. Where his parents' sex shop got busted for a drug paraphernalia. I love how the final segment of the show was, we're going to promote the pay-per-view. Look at all these shows we have coming up. Alright, so that was the first episode that we're going to watch of Saturday Night. We're going to watch another one here in a second. Couple of notes real quick. Next week, we're going to go back to 1992, the beginning of the Bill Watts era of WCW for WCW Power Hour. Two episodes, return of commercials. Also, I wanted to run something by you guys. In a few weeks, I'm thinking of maybe doing an Oops, No WCW episode, where we watch a couple episodes of old wrestling TV not from WCW. I'm thinking global. I'm throwing it out for you guys. If you think it's a cool idea, thumbs up. If not, thumbs down. I'm not offended if you don't like it. I'm just throwing it out. Also planning another Oops No Wrestling episode coming up. Got a couple game shows, maybe some talk show stuff. That's all coming up in the next few weeks. But with that, we're going to go back to Saturday night the following week. Let's go.
One of the most tumultuous weeks.
All right, seeing a lot of positive feedback to that idea.
The tonight on WCW Saturday Night. I'm Scott Hudson, joined
all right, so I think we might watch some Global Wrestling Federation in a couple weeks. And yeah, we're definitely doing the Oops No Wrestling episode. I've already got a couple game shows. I've got some talk show stuff, some news reports. Always a good time. So, all right, cool. We will put that on the schedule. Maybe 2 weeks from today. Watch the Global Wrestling Federation.
It's no longer around the waist of Hollywood Hogan. It's no longer the possession of the NWO.
Starting off with the Renegade.
Goldberg is the world heavyweight champion. WCW on top of the wrestling world.
And make fun of, because then it'll be very mean. Look at Jim Neidhart, though, misspelled with a leather do-rag. Look at this guy. That's where Natty gets the fashion sense. Look at that jacket! What happened to it? He got that jacket the year before. He was in the Hart Foundation in 97. What the fuck happened to that jacket?
That he was willing, I think, to just dissolve NWO Hollywood. Just so
I don't know what what era we'll be watching. I'm gonna scroll through some. I have access to a good chunk of GWF stuff. But I don't know what we might watch. A lot of the stuff, the GWF stuff though, that I have, I found, has commercials, which I know is always a plus. Yeah, Jim Neidhart does not look well. He's lost a lot of size. Oh jeez. Yeah, we'll definitely try to find some Hollywood John Tatum. That guy amuses me to no end.
The Renegade in trouble. Neidhart grabs him by the hair.
Sheamus's thing.
A vicious forearm across the chest.
Yeah, Bulldog would turn purple doing promos. There's that famous backstage blast interview, like the commercial break between the Nitros that DirecTV would show, where Bulldog's face is—he looks like he's being choked. He's just standing.
Both of us have been following his career for so many years. Bret Hart went absolutely over the edge. But you have to admit, Scott, he did give a warning to everyone in the WCW locker room. Beware, Bret Hart.
Yeah, Jim ain't looking well here. I would have maybe said don't send him out to the ring. But not if they had 300 guys in the locker room. I will say, I will give him props for at least, like, sporting some, it looks like, some fresh hair dye. Yeah, I love, Pat brings up something. I love the wrestling transitive law of religion. That if my cousin or my brother higher up on the card turns heel, I have to as well.
Hollywood Hogan in the spotlight.
Happened a lot, especially back then.
The new world's heavyweight champion, Bret Hart, wants to be in the world's title picture in the worst way.
And his brother-in-law, Jim the Anvil Neidhart, now has Renegade in a pretty precarious position here on Saturday night.
Oh yeah, Bret's doing all this stuff, and Jim Neidhart's wrestling Renegade.
Warning Neidhart to be careful. Potential disqualification averted by
yeah, that was a weird JYD run in 93 with Jim Neidhart.
Obviously taking away his wind capacity.
Jim Neidhart doing the Anvilizer as a finisher, the Cobra Clutch.
Clubbing forearm across the upper back of the former television champion Renegade. Now into the go behind. What's he got on him, Mike? Today just ripping his mouth apart, looks like.
Yeah, variation of a reverse chin lock at this point from Neidhart. Just a neutralizing move here. Not going to gain a submission win from this, but obviously an attempt to wear down his opponent, the Renegade.
Well, it's doing it. Renegade, now horizontal, sitting down. Jim the Anvil Neidhart into the rear chin lock position. Referee Charles Robinson checking. Renegade.
Dude, if my brother David turned heel, I'd be like, dude, you're on your own. Mostly because he and I don't see eye to eye in a lot of things. But also, he chews tobacco, and I think that's gross.
with a high vertical suplex of his
puts
own.
Barry Darsow
blocked
him
twice. Suplex the anvil over. The anvil misses with the right. Blocked by Renegade. Renegade firing back with the right hands of his own.
And this is all right. Like, there's effort being put in. It's just the Jim Neidhart might be the first wrestler I've ever seen to have cold sweats while also having warm sweats. What the? Okay. All right. At least that was a decent power slam. Look at that, man. Look at him. Doing that shit. Come on, man. At least, like, hide it. Mike Tenay's peeing below the camera, it looks like.
Former Flock member Saturn takes on current Flock member Sick.
This is when Sick Boy is like, you know what? The transplanting stuff's a bit extreme. I'm just going to be a guy now.
The phenomenon that is Goldberg has been absolutely phenomenal, especially in terms of the World Championship Wrestling Organization. I guess we're nearing now the two-week anniversary of Goldberg's first ever title reign, and everywhere you go from the WCW...
Yeah, Mike Tenay looks like he just got away with something.
You can just feel a rebirth.
Like, right before they went on camera,
WCW
he's like,
organization. Nothing
hey,
like
Scott.
Hearing those chants in the arenas.
You ever hear
Seymour
Butts?
It definitely deserves another
one. Nobody's seen more butts than you, Scott Hudson. Let's roll.
Heavyweight title also later in this program.
If you were there in the Georgia
Mike Tenay, I believe, is retired in Las Vegas. He was working he was an odds maker in Las Vegas. Even during this time, even while he's like working for WCW, he's working at various Vegas casinos setting odds for sporting events.
He realizes that WCW is back on top of the pecking order.
There's the tent. The Mike Tenay tent is back. This is where all the luchadors had to stay because WCW would not get them a hotel room, and they had to stay in Mike Tenay's little tent.
Dave Pinzer's grabbed a mic. Let's go to the ring.
I love how he words it like Dave Pinzer went like rogue. Oh shit, Pinzer's got the mic. And here we go. Disorderly conduct.
Mean Mike leads the way to the ring and Tough Tom follows.
Ben Pasco in the chat. Here's the church, here's the people, here's where we keep the Lucha people.
They are about
That's
to make
bad.
Their way to the ring on Saturday night.
Team number two, introducing...
You know what, drugs?
From Brooklyn, New York,
Mike Tenay seemed like the type of weird pervert that would be very into Leisure Suit Larry. We got something there.
Good night. Look at that shirt.
Adjust your sets. What color would you call that, Scott? Like a neon green?
Looking like a shirt that Jennifer Aniston would have worn at this time.
Planes attempting to land here in the arena.
Lee Marshall's dead, classic wrestling review. Not to be depressing, he's very dead.
Look at the tights.
R.I.P. to Lee Marshall.
Wins, and this guy's spending all of his money on tights and weirdo plastic shirts.
Weirdo plastic shirts. I think that's the show title. Thank you, Scott Hudson. There we go, baby. Alex Wright.
Great. The mascot for the dancing fool.
And we got Magnum Tokyo.
I guess he idolizes Alex Wright.
Oh, brother.
Mimicking every move of Alex Wright. We're speaking of Tokyo Magnum.
I love that, like, this is just like a goof thing that they did in WCW, and then he would still do this dance when he went back to Toruman and was like a legit top guy there.
What a wake-up call for the team of the Disco Inferno and Alex Wright this past
and he would
Monday
still do
Nitro,
that dance.
They went into the ring with the NWO Wolfpack duo of the Total Package, Lex Luger and
with the shame
Nash. Gentlemen,
that like the Toruman WCW relationship didn't go past this group on excursion. Imagine like Milano Collection 18 or Anthony W. Mori, Super Shiza, all those dudes over WCW. That would have been dope.
On Nitro.
Well, the duo of Alex Wright and the Disco Inferno,
I might do a Florida Brothers rain, match. Problem is, Noli, I think, thinks this stuff's lame now. He hasn't asked to do one in a few weeks. I think he thinks Twitch is lame and old. But if he does another one, I'll have to do a Florida Brothers match.
Anytime you see the public enemy, anytime you see the dancing fools in the ring, you can rest assured that the other team is somewhere nearby scouting and probably plotting some type of interference. It could involve chairs.
I love how, like, awkwardly disorderly conduct singlets are cut.
When you see WCW action live and in,
because it's not like it's not like a regular singlet where it kind of comes down like mid thigh. It goes down to about like knee level, but doesn't go down far enough to be like the traditional like Bret Hart style. Oh no, Brian just made a point.
Are you ready, Windy City? You can meet Goldberg at Dominance on South Ashland Avenue this Friday from 11 a.m.
Good thing they didn't last until World War III. If you can't see it, Brian said, wait a second. Alex Wright's German, Disco's Italian, Magnum Tokyo's Japanese. Yes, the dance and axis of evil. I never thought about that, but Kevin Sullivan's a history nerd, and I bet that's exactly where his mind
is. Notify security now.
They're going to be lined up for weeks out there. Mean Mike now opening up for Disco Inferno.
They probably, I mean, this wasn't the FBI, but I mean, they put Disco in with Big Vito and Johnny the Bull when he did a mobster thing. So,
for Mean Mike,
almost Leno-esque, isn't it?
Leno-esque, very nice. Mean Mike opening up, they're in the wrong part of town out there. Tag made to Tough Tom, double team from disorderly conduct. Disco shot in, double boot to the midsection, looks like a double suplex coming up.
Look at that. Disorderly conduct doing a move.
Alex Wright in to make the save.
Alex Wright's like, I'm not gonna wait for this pin.
Oh, Disco!
He swerved him with that dance move.
A dance distraction by Alex Wright allowed Disco to put the forearm on top. Tom, reverse atomic drop.
It is wild seeing Alex Wright next to these quote unquote normal sized wrestlers, and he's still like over a head taller. And you think, oh, this guy was in the cruiserweight division.
Tokyo Magnum still at ringside. Lateral press. Just a two count for Alex before the outside interference.
Mean Mike making the save for his partner in disorderly conduct.
Yeah, pretty much. Him back outside. Or in the case of Jacqueline, they were met at Disco. And they wanted him to lose to a lady. Because that's embarrassing, don't you know?
Yeah, it is. That's that dancing distraction again.
Snap suplex into the bridge by Alex.
You bring up Tony Mamalu being a manager in WCW. The reason why he was a manager in WCW was because of the way he wrestled. He wrestled in Power Plant, or he was trained in the Power Plant for a while after being like a Florida indie guy. And in the Power Plant, I believe he got 12 concussions was the actual like number they counted, and they're like, dude, you can't wrestle. Like, it'd be irresponsible for us to have you wrestle. And then they made him a manager, and then they fired him. And then ECW was like 12 concussions? That's not nearly enough. But yeah, he had, like, before he even got to ECW, his brain was mush. But it was a rare case of somebody in WCW actually being responsible. Being like, you should not be wrestling. I love this. They're beating up their own guy. That's great. I love WCW. But he's still dancing. Come on, guys. Why did you kick me? We're gonna dance. Again, the Attitude Era, where you would just break tables on the show that nobody was watching. Oh, jeez. Johnny, don't do a flip. Okay. Oh, jeez.
and Tokyo Magnum.
He fell off of the ropes.
Than Alex Wright in the Disco Inferno.
Disco and Alex will win the match, but the public enemy stands tall on Saturday night.
That was a good table break. That table broke very well, though. The referee, and they left it in. That's
it
awesome.
The most talked about pay-per-view of the year from WCW and NWO last Sunday night, the Cox Arena in San Diego, California.
Cox Arena.
It was back at the beach, 98. Bret the Hitman Hart.
I at least understand what they're doing stills here. They're trying to sell replays.
Booker T by tonight.
And it was the first time that Bret Hart had ever challenged for the WCW World TV title.
And even contest early on, both men taking advantage, giving advantage. Booker T seemed to be in control, and then Bret the Hitman Hart dumped Booker T over the top.
That probably ended badly.
Hart came into play. There you see Hart wielding the steel chair and using the figure four leg lock wrapped around the post of the champ. Booker T.
His brother Stevie Ray makes his way to ringside.
Of course, Stevie Ray walked out, didn't do a run in it. He did a walk in.
Knee injury at the hands of Bret the Hitman Hart. How much help was Stevie Ray to his brother? That is still to be determined. But Booker T is.
It's such a weird run, the Bret Hart WCW run. Comes in with all this steam, and then he just kind of becomes like.
The equivalent of
another Arn Anderson,
Stevie
I guess.
Ray has a championship belt. Is that the World TV title? He hasn't won a title.
Yeah,
man.
I forgot this. Stevie Ray. I forgot both that Stevie Ray did have the TV title because Booker was hurt, and that Rick Martel came back after he got hurt. I completely forgot that Martel came back after Super Bowl.
But this time, his brother Stevie Ray uses the feet to his advantage. Pick up. Now forget about it. Martel slipped and came up in a belly to back.
Picked him up, dumped him nice. Not quite a big enough arc he should have had to get some steps. But again, could be because Martel's knee is not 100%. But with arc.
Wonder if Don Callis has called up his old buddy Rick Martel. Trying to get him into AEW. Oh, jeez. Oh, no. Why, Brett? I love how Bret always brags like, oh, I never hurt anybody. Wrestling is the art of making things look like... And then he just fucking brains Martel in the back of the head with a chair when his hands are, like, at his sides. Bret Hart, the guy's career was ended. And then, of course, the finish is a face drop thing. I'm surprised Rick Martel retired after this. I'm surprised he wasn't brain dead. You guys saw that chair shot. Oh my goodness.
My brother is in a hospital.
Bret Hart never hurt anyone my ass. And I'm a Bret guy. I like Bret better than Sean. That was bullshit.
What are you doing with the World Television title?
Because my brother gave me power of attorney to defend his
I love that in wrestling, power of attorney means you can just defend their championship.
Earlier in this segment, Mike, we saw
yeah, I can sign leases for my brother. I can sign checks, and I can defend his wrestling championships.
To defend the World Television Championship, and then last Thursday night.
Wow, there was a new Metal Maniac, and he wrestled Rick Martel in his retirement.
Document gives it to Tony Schiavone, claims it's the power of attorney.
There we go. Bobby Blaze, the guy who got a job in WCW because Jim Cornette pushed him for like 3 weeks at the end of Smoky Mountain.
That his brother Booker T had admitted to him
they sing Mikey Knows. Hell yeah, Bender. I'm sure that looks badass. I'm surprised there isn't more of a bedazzling community in the wrestling figure customization community. This just seems like a no-brainer. Like bedazzling a figure, because like, wrestlers wear that stuff all over them. Look how high Bobby Blaze's trunks are.
Of his brother. We do know that Booker T is going to be sidelined the better part of 4 or 6 weeks.
Like, I don't think he's that old here. Like, I think he's in like his 50s now. And he's wearing his trunks like a real old man.
Wow.
Hello, Henry. Yeah, when it comes to the custom figures, I feel like people, like most people, just stop at painting. But like, there's a lot more I feel like you can do if you have the time and the creativity that people just aren't like going with. So hell yeah, I'm bedazzling. Hell yeah, I would definitely welcome that.
And see if we can't get some kind of a comment pertaining to his brother and the situation as it revolves around the world's television championship belt.
Bobby Blaze, I believe Mike Enos' tights have both a heart rate monitor and a license plate on the butt. I don't know what those two things have to do with each other at all, but they're there.
Bobby Blaze is certainly impressive.
Roadblock is getting an action figure from, I think it's the Heels and Faces line. Oh, geez. One of those action figure groups that, like, came out of the whole Major Wrestling Figure podcast boom. Like, he's getting, like, a Hasbro-style figure. Oh, geez. Oh, geez! Mike Enos is just laying feet first on Bobby Blaze's head.
And Monday Nitro on the way. Tickets will go on sale next Friday, July the 24th, for a Nitro in Hartford on August 17th.
I completely missed just 69 on 69 and not one. And there is a subtle word to the drop down, back up, leapfrog, do it again.
Friday, July the 24th from 9 a.m. to noon.
Oh, geez.
Bret Hart and the Nitro Girls. Is it that a unique combination?
Their block's just going to be skinned old and slow.
Lined up around the block. Get there early.
Dude, somebody pointed out to me this week, I didn't even realize that the old Draws figures back in the day were just repainted Mark Maros. I didn't even realize it, and then yeah, like, for some reason Draws had boxing tape on his fists. He never wore that. That makes sense.
No one is safe in world championship wrestling. He despises not only the wrestlers, but also the fans, and claims he's not
also great, great tube socks. Oh, jeez, that was great.
But he's not a liar. And if Bret Hart tells me not to get around him, to beware of his wrath, he can...
Also, shout out to Nick Patrick. Last week, he looked like he was, he's going to go tour with a fog hat. This week, looks like he's going to be third trombonist for the Mighty Mighty Boston's with his slick back hair.
Back to the Booker T. Stevie Ray situation.
Also, shout out to everybody on, antidepressant and anxiety medication. I'm about ready to take my nighttime med. There we go. Down the hatch. I will be very sleepy in about an hour.
He's a businessman too. He knows contracts. He knows everything about the business part of being a champion. He is not going to give a handwritten power of attorney to his brother.
Hell yeah. Shout out to everybody in the chat. Also, who needs some chemical help with their brain waves. Hell yeah. I don't even know how to pronounce it. It's like Mertzler-Clean.
Enos sets him up. Scoop slam in the corner. Bobby Blaze draped over the top turnbuckle by Mike Enos.
Patrick is a guy 148.
Oh, here we go. Enos is setting him up.
You know, dude, I'm sure in one of those, like, Jasmine St. Clair videos back in the day, like, if you watch, there's no way there aren't at least a couple wrestlers, just numbers-wise. That was a cool finish. Hell yeah, JJ,
50-15.
When we come back, a look at the unseemly Chris Jericho.
At the unseemly Chris Jericho. That needs to be his next nickname in AEW.
Hi again, Gene Okerlund.
Gene Okerlund, apparently wearing bullets on him.
Is taking place.
What are those suspenders? He's wearing leather suspenders.
Bash at the Beach, Nitro, Thunder, everything that's going on in this great organization. Plus, I'm going to be telling you the facts about what's happening in the World Wrestling Federation.
What?
on the WCW Hotline.
He's going to be telling us the facts about the World Wrestling Federation? No way!
The huge one,
no
the
way, Gene.
Mark Madden every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday.
That's
and
a th- Why is Mark Madden on the Hotline so much?
And everything, and I do mean everything.
Everybody else gets one day. Mark Madden gets like half the
I'll
week.
I'll have the complete story on the return to the ring of a former WCW champion. Yes, that's the night of the Hotline, so...
I'm sure it's like, oh, Greg Valentine worked his first indie in 3 months. I'm sure that was what it was. Yeah, Gene looks like a fucking detective. Right now. Looks like he's about to ready to get back to his desk and solve the case of the... He looks like he's about to go handle those kids that stole Eric's bike yesterday.
On Thunder from Oakland, your exclusive interview.
Here we go. Hell yeah. Shout out to his animal, the Michael Jordan, professional wrestler, the gambler. Again, if you weren't here at the beginning of the stream, go check out the gambler's interview on Chris Jericho's podcast last week. Talk is Jericho.
Kevin Nash calls you in. I knew that he had something to get off of his chest.
I should do like a gimmick thing. Like whenever the gambler's on air, should be like, everybody subscribe now. Make the gambler pop up in the corner because I got the gambler thing. I'm not going to do that though because...
I think Kevin Nash said it best. Brothers by blood.
Okay, so the Gambler episode of Talk is Jericho, I don't know if it's because I listened to it like right when it went up, like Wednesday morning, or what. There were no ads. Like, I don't, like a premium thing, there were no ads. It was just a straight 45-minute interview. So, hell yeah, though. The Gambler and Norman Smiley. Is that guy named Rhett is holding up a sign for himself in the background.
And Hollywood Hogan, they were sure there to step up to the plate to take care of Scott Hall in those circumstances.
Well, I guess for Scott Hall, it all comes down to the bottom line. And Eric Bischoff and Hollywood Hogan.
That was cool. I like that. Keep it on to the wrist lock.
Which is what a true friend would do.
Well, he went for the leg trip.
With just the cash would be there for a little more emotional support. But Scott Hall, I'm so disappointed. Regardless of what time.
Yeah, no, the gambler. If you weren't here when I was glowing about it before, gambler just seemed like such a sweet old man that loved his 9 years in wrestling and was like. I was in, I was out, I was on TV, I have all this footage of me wrestling all these famous guys, and now I do what I do. Shout out to Jexy6XD, Jexy6XD, however you pronounce it, welcome to the group, welcome to us. Thank you so much for following. Appreciate you bringing the saltine crackers and the half-drinking generic soda.
And later in this segment, we will recap those tremendous...
Funny story, Brian, you bring up about the gambler's hair. He said on the podcast, apparently he had long hair. There, I found a Jeff Gamble match from like NWA main event where he had like long hair. And then I guess the story he told on the podcast is he was training in Georgia and Ole Anderson walks in the training school. He's like, you gotta cut that hair, buddy. You'll look much better without the hair. And he walks in the next day. It's like, yeah, he looks like Arn Anderson. And I guess that was Ole's thing. He wanted to make him look like Arn.
Jim Lampley. That begins tonight. And it will continue every night at 8:05 Eastern. 3 solid hours of coverage all the way up to the conclusion.
It's not a wrestling show without a Jim Lampley reference and commentary.
And if you're checking your calendar, that will affect the WCW Thunder schedule. Much more about that still to come on Saturday night.
Oh no, Jim Lampley is fucking with WCW Thunder.
Norman Smiley across that bottom rope now just wrenching the neck.
Well, the magic man Norman Smiley, born in England, moved to Mexico City where he's been wrestling.
Bob Huntley claims he lost his hair from wrestling a bear.
Also has quite a background.
Bob Huntley was
wrestling, so he can beat you.
When the fuck did Bob Huntley wrestle a bear?
Well, may have well scouted Norman Smiley, a little submission action there, dropping the elbow.
Like they were doing wrestling bears when he got when he went bald. I assume Bob Huntley just lost his hair from bleaching it so much.
Will not play into it if he's got a bad wheel or a bad arm.
Series of shoulder blocks.
Yeah, dude, I'm telling the gambler should have been
pinfall attempt.
Like when the NWO did like NWO Sting, they should have brought, when Arn retired, they should have brought in the Gamblers, NWO Arn Anderson.
Quickly to his feet, Norman.
That would have been great.
Catches him with the lariat, slightly off guard. Gambler trying to clear the cobwebs.
Yeah, there's no way Bob Holly wrestled a bear, or at least wrestled a bear when he went bald. Bob Holly went bald in like 99. He wasn't defending the WWF Hardcore title against bears.
Oh, that stopped him.
The only, really, the only Barry defended against was Albert. It's like the lost Bob Holly match in Arena Mexico. Him against a bear. There we go.
Oh, my.
That knee was not meant to bend that far that way, and the Gambler will attest to
that. That knee was meant to bend like that, because that's the way you bend a knee, Scott Hudson. This is going to be... Look at that. That's cool. That knee bar is pretty dope.
Weakened knee and ankle. Referee Mark Curtis checking with the Gambler. He taps out.
Man, if Bob Holly wrote that, and I mean, I don't remember that in Bob Holly's book. I'm not saying it wasn't in there, because my memory sucks. Bob Holly's book was really good, but I do not. If he said a bear caused his hair loss.
2.5 years ago, when we came in together as the outsiders, I mean, we started this thing, and. And one thing we said was, you know, money was important, but we give as much as we could together.
Shoot.
We're brothers by blood, you know, we're best friends by choice.
This is a shoot.
And, I mean, I've had plenty of times where, you know, I've got in there with my blood brother, but, I mean, here's a guy that...
You know, it's a shoot because he didn't put conditioner in his hair.
I've spent more time with him than I have even my wife. I mean, we've been up and down these roads, and... I know him better than probably he knows himself sometimes, or probably vice versa, and it just... I mean, when we touched tonight, it was magic, and I thought we had it, and for him to do what he did...
When
just,
you touched tonight, it was magic. I'm sure that it was a... He said the Nitro Girl Shay.
I've been around Hogan now for 2 years, Bischoff the same, and... I mean, they're ruthless, they're cutthroat, and, you know... To me, it's like... They can't deal with me one-on-one, so they basically deal with my family. They attack my family, which is Scott.
Why is he so sad?
Right, and, I mean, I don't think I'm going to be able to do anything but, you know, maybe beat some sense into him.
You saw this big 6'10 goof that I've been carrying his whole career.
I love how the Kevin Nash interview is like, I'm so sad. My best friend, he left me. And then the Skull interview is like, this big goof. Fuck him. Hey, yo.
How about a little cheese to go with that wine?
Oh, Scott.
It's all about the Benjamins.
Oh, that's the rap song you listen to that one.
You know that I went through a little personal crisis, and I lost a lot of money. And you know who gave me money back? It wasn't you.
This is, yeah, a few months later is when they do the angle where Scott Hall threw up cream of mushrooms. Again, 69 and on, we exploring each other's bodies. Again, as we talked about a few weeks ago when we were watching that German pay-per-view, Kevin Nash wanted to do an angle where the Outsiders were gay. Like, they were tough, buff dudes. They just happened to fuck each other.
The eyes of the sports and entertainment world.
Like, if that's where this all would have gone, like they do a Golden Lovers thing, like Kenny and Kota, but they take it even further.
Diamond Dallas Page proved to be a tough match for the Worm, Dennis Rodman, taking over. But Hollywood Hogan was equal to the task, taking over on the mailman Karl Malone, dropping.
Man, if Bob Holly ever wrestled Andres of the Giant Panda,
opening up on Diamond Dallas Page, man, as Dennis Rodman looked on approvingly
from the apron. That would have been dope. Just a giant panda.
The front face lock on Page, but Page makes the tag.
the hot tag to the mailman, Carl Malone, who cleans house on Hollywood Hogan.
NWO Black and White appeared to be in control until Malone came in, scoop slam.
If you don't know, this is the famous match where Dennis Rodman fell asleep in the corner, just laid his head down on the turnbuckle, and missed like half the match.
There's a diamond cutter on Hollywood Hogan by DDP, but waiting in the ring. The disciple.
Of course, Beefcake got to do a run in. That video of Beefcake filming his wife begging Hulk Hogan to drop the beef was so funny. If you haven't seen it, it's on social media this week. You're gonna hear Beefcake go in action at the beginning. It's so funny.
Disciple, you want some? Come get some! You will feel that!
Oh yeah, I have no doubt in my mind Brutus Beefcake needs a job. Also, I don't know if you guys saw, I think it was last week, Beefcake threw out the first pitch in a minor league ball game, but for some reason he didn't put the hedge clippers that he brought with him down, so he's trying to throw a pitch. I think he was throwing with the wrong arm, and he had hedge clippers he was trying not to cut himself with, and then they took a picture, and it's like this? Like, it looks like he's like sneezing or coming or something while he's throwing the ball. It's so funny.
After what happened here,
it's awesome.
And he did it without having to use the diamond cutter. Diamond Jealous Page answers the challenge.
The Beefcake first pitch picture. Like, I don't know if he's got like a shit. Or it's like the arms at an awkward angle. He's making like a poop face. He's got hedge clippers going up in his armpit. It's something. Look at that brutal chair shot from Hulk Hogan. Look at that thing. You can tell Rude's training for a comeback because he got the Chuck Liddell haircut going on. Also, I'm a big fan of this era of DDP where he got like vinyl jeans to wear to the ring. Like, they have pockets and shit.
Just absolutely very, very disgusting fun. What we saw on Nitro, the most vicious Hollywood Hogan we've ever come across.
The intensity.
It's Scott Putski.
Hollywood Hogan and the NWO Black and White.
All right, it's great having you here, Classic Crash. We'll interview you. We'll be back next week. See you then.
To regain the
yes, Brutus Beefcake looks like he's doing like T-Rex
arms.
He made it very clear, he being Hollywood Hogan, made it very clear on Nitro.
Yeah, we got Scott Putski. Scott Putski.
NWO Wolfpack.
Doing like sexy gothic.
He wants it all. He wants to be king of the hill again.
Or Julio Sanchez. Imagine being such a low tier job guy that you don't get an entrance in the match where your opponent is Scott Putski. Everybody else on these shows tonight has gotten an entrance.
They are out to get the NWO Black and White back on top.
Polish.
They'll do anything that it takes, as we witnessed last Monday night with that chair attack on DDP Diamond Dallas Page.
And also the head games being played with Kevin Nash by Scott.
Great hair on Putski.
That has got to be part of Hollywood Hogan's.
Maybe he stole all the conditioner that Kevin Nash was
not wearing. And don't forget that Hogan
that
mentioned
interview.
Goldberg this past Monday on Nitro, told him that he was not only on the trail, but his days were numbered, and Hogan was going to prove that Goldberg was nothing more than a flash in the pan.
I can't wait to see another match between Hollywood Hogan and Goldberg. Talk about making
I love how these two look
Goldberg
like different Pokemon evolutions of each other.
That settles it for me. Julio Sanchez and Scott Putski.
Look at that.
Night. Wow, guillotine leg drop over the middle.
And like an actual cradle.
The leg and the neck by Julio Sanchez, only got the two count on Putski.
Well, Sanchez went airborne that time. High risk move. Connecting
I don't
that
know
Scott Putski.
Who's that Pokemon?
Getting out of the starting block here against Sanchez. Back heel press, lateral press. Look at that. He doesn't even go for the cover. Just throttling him with that chokehold.
Blatant choke by Julio Sanchez.
And to think, Julio Sanchez is only a year away from being a hero of wrestling. From being the trivia question answered to the question, who was the youngest person on the Heroes of Wrestling pay-per-view? Julio Sanchez, good on you, Mike, today for trying to use an accent on the A.
Almost whiplash-like.
Shoots Putski in.
Oh, jeez. That was a rough one.
Putski almost took Sanchez's head off.
Speaking of a whiplash, Scott Putski back in.
There's a lot going on Scott Putski's tights. I see a crucifix. I see an eagle.
Sanchez, look at the look on his face. He's all but out, and Putski, that's not going to help.
See maybe a dagger going through the eagle's body. Plus, he wore all the vampire stuff to the ring.
That made his father, the legendary Ivan Putski, the Polish power. Here we go.
Oh, jeez. The Putski bomb.
Rolls him up. Two and three. And Scott
he, believe Julio Sanchez is a couple years younger than Scorpio, who defeated him on the Heroes of Wrestling.
Seat. Scott Putski turns it around, gains the pin with the
Putski bomb. What do you say, another day
Jericho,
bomb?
Jericho, Malenko, and Mysterio when we come back.
Wait, what? Just a random Dean Malenko Rey Mysterio match? See, that I don't look at the match lists for like these later era WCW shows. Because they're just going to send anybody out of the curtain. We got Scott Putski followed by Dean Malenko and Rey Mysterio. Why not?
Mysterio Jr. returned and became world cruiserweight champion. But what happened the next night on Nitro had to be seen to be believed.
Well, Scott, the king of all loopholes strikes again.
Strikes again. Look at that eyebrow. King of all loopholes.
I have to agree there is a rule that claims that if a suspended wrestler has some effect on the outcome of a match, that match has to be thrown out.
True, Baby as Bundy, result, the manager, might have been.
Jericho is once again
might have been
the world's
around the same age
champion,
as Julio. That's a good point, JJ.
Let's go back in time to the MGM Grand Garden Arena in Vegas for WCW Nitro.
You know, if Tanae and Hudson put their heads together, they have one full haircut.
San Diego, Rey Mysterio Jr.
Well, I love the J.J. Dillon thing when he comes up for like a good announcement. Puts his hands on his tummy.
Let's bring him out. Welcome, Las Vegas, Rey Mysterio Jr. Wait a minute. Hold on. Mr. Jericho, not again.
I miss when like Chris Jericho would walk out of the screen and I would be like, he's sad.
You know, I hate to rain on the parade of the so-called new champion here. But Junior, put on your slicker, because there's going to be a downpour.
Dude, Jericho's jorts are so tight.
For the safety of the athletes involved.
He wears leather pants now that look baggier than those jorts.
And if he is present and affects the outcome of said match, the decision of the aforementioned match is null and void.
That's right, Henry, you are from San Diego.
Well, technically correct. Is he correct? Is that belt belong to
619.
Him?
619. Well,
yes. You tell this little punk, you tell Ron Mysterio Jr. to give me my belt back. Give it back there, Jr.
No. He wants the belt. Yes, he wants the belt back. And apparently on a technicality.
That Dean Malenko shirt. Yeah, he did just say Ron Mysterio. This is at the point where Chris Jericho was actually very witty and amusing.
I did, Stinko Malenko! I did! And I'll tell you what, since you think you're so bad, and since Ron Mysterio thinks he's so bad, I'm a fair man.
JJ would have been a good authority figure in another era. The problem is, the NWO was all like, oh, we're cool and we're hip, and we're, you know, like dads who listen to DMX. And the WCW sends out JJ Dillon, like, why you listen, you guys? Give your brother his ball back. Okay, so apparently we're not actually getting this match. Special highlights. Still, it's fine.
Right to the Frankensteiner, did Mysterio countered into a gutbuster by Malenko.
And Mickey J checking on Rey Mysterio Jr. to see if he's up
there. Jericho's out.
He's wielding the belt like a ball bat.
I don't know why more dudes didn't whip dudes with their championship belts. I know you do the thing where you hold it. Hit him with it. I feel like whipping somebody with a championship belt would hurt a little more.
So Mysterio gets the shot at Jericho in the cruiserweight title.
Of course he has.
You know what? Jericho's picking his own opponent. That's what he's doing.
Of course
she is.
You hit the nail on the head there.
And you two guys had the audacity to stand up for this jerk.
We were standing up for the rules.
You love Tony Schiavone. You two
this
assholes.
Sunday, Nitro emanates from Salt Lake City and the E Center. Join us at
one of many words I knew the meaning of way too early because
see
of wrestling.
The stars of World Championship Wrestling. The NWO Black and White representing Hollywood Hogan as well as the NWO Wolfpack. It's live this Monday, July the 20th.
This Monday on Nitro, the same guys that are always there every week.
For 3 hours of Nitro.
It pains me to call this man a champion of anything. But regardless,
there's a guy in the ring.
Who's
this guy that we're paying to watch? Alright, it's Chris Jericho.
Jericho has the gold around his waist.
Scott Hudson, I hate to do this, but for once I have to agree with Chris Jericho. Yes, he's the king of all loopholes, loves to use any technicality that he can, not afraid to go to the WCW rulebook, but there's a reason that you have a rulebook. Dean Malenko was suspended by World Championship Wrestling and the Executive Committee last Sunday at Bash at the Beach. For the safety of the athletes involved, Malenko was not allowed to be present.
Okay, good on Jackie Crockett or whoever cameraman that was to sell the kiss.
And his World Cruiserweight title reign was eclipsed.
We got Chris Jericho. Oh, Barry Houston. Barry Houston. I'm a big fan of Barry Houston. Great and handsome guy.
He had
a great match with Jushin Liger once on an episode of WCW Pro. He was one of the few guys like from the pre-2000 indie generation who went over to Europe to learn that style. Like a Nashville guy, but like apparently he got in real tight with like Norman Smiley and Fit Finlay and all of them in WCW. He did tours of England.
Why does he need these loopholes? He's talented enough to get in the ring and win the strap back himself on his own talents.
Yeah, I'm a big Barry Houston
guy. Is in a situation now where he's going to do anything within his power to avoid that contact, to avoid that confrontation with
I'm not a big fan of Barry Houston's Brad from Home Improvement haircut.
Backstage
gotta grow hair on all the sides of the head. You're not meant for an undercut.
He can to avoid Malenko. Double A, the enforcer, Arn Anderson, cut him off at the path last Sunday.
Good job, Double A. That's kind of a redundancy, isn't it? Side headlock by Chris Jericho as he defends the World's Cruiserweight title against young Barry Houston on
Saturday
night.
There's so much product in Nick Patrick's hair. Like, it looks like he just took whatever was on the bathroom counter and just threw it in there and then just did one of these things.
Grabs the wrist.
Like, that hair is not moving.
In terms of experience factor, Barry Houston is not in the same league with Chris Jericho.
No.
But we certainly have been impressed with Barry Houston's showing both on our...
He does the old Cornish hype
on WCW Saturday night in the past.
Of a side headlock
takeover. Talk about the biggest opportunity of this young man's career. This is it right here with the cruiserweight belt on the line.
And although it's
yes,
an amazing opportunity for young
Barry
Houston,
you've got to
think
Cornish
that
hype.
Barry Houston is hardly the number one contender for the cruiserweight title.
Oh, shit, he went mouth first. Sup, Homosaur? Thank you for the follow. I needed some more saltines and generic Eric Soda.
We saw that earlier.
Hell yeah, we need somebody to bring back the Cornish hype.
Basically picked his own opponent for a cruiserweight title defense. The man just knows no
yeah, that's the thing. Nick Patrick, as much stuff as he put in his hair, still at least has the second best head of hair.
Nicely executed high vertical.
Nick Patrick, he counted slow because he put so much in his hair. It weighs his hand down.
A one count, not even a two count for Jericho.
Well, that may be the most nonchalant of all covers that we've seen. Oh, could you believe that? He questions the official.
Please, not a textbook cover.
Well, how dare he question the official that's been cheating for the past 2 years?
Interesting to note that in Providence, Rhode Island, World Championship Wrestling is bringing an arena event on August the 16th. Tickets will go on sale next Saturday, July the 25th, at the Providence Civic Center box office and Ticketmaster. Plus, you can meet Bret Hart and the Nitro Girls at the Civic Center next Saturday from 10 to 11:30, and then at the Warwick Mall at noon that next Saturday, July the 25th.
Jericho charges in and misses on Barry Houston. Houston fires back with a boot in the midsection. A clubbing forearm across the back of Chris Jericho and the championship. Oh, hang on. Go behind by Jericho.
And Bret Hart and the Nitro Girls. That sounds like a recipe for another chapter in Bret's book. If you ever read Bret's book, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Oh, geez. You think Bret was like a dick to Whisper? Like,
close to a new
How
champion.
Dare you?
I don't think Chris Jericho knew what he was picking when he picked Barry Houston as a challenger.
You think he walked into Whisper? Why would you date that guy? You know that he screwed me, right? And Whisper being new to wrestling. What? Sean, I didn't know you. Yeah. Oh, Jesus.
I don't blame it. Chris Jericho will retain your cruiserweight title with the victory.
A lot of people came to see the
over a very game, Barry Houston. Let's take another
unfortunately, they did not see them.
Now
shows.
That was a valiant effort by Barry Houston in the role of the challenger. There we see Jericho leveling with the shoulder block, sends him off into the ropes.
I'm very glad that Bret's book was like 600 pages long, so it can protect your elbow from being broken.
First, I've got to ask, what is up with you guys and Alex Wright and Disco Inferno?
You crazy leader insane in the membrane, not you. No loco, something Mrs. Screw Loose, you know what I'm talking about, Staggerly?
I mean, Rocker Rock quoting the only two rap songs he's listened to.
Like we always do, we can't wrestle good, you know. And they come out there from behind our back, they be kicking us in the back, hitting us, stomping us while we're down. I don't like that stuff, see? I don't believe turn the other cheek.
No.
You turn the other cheek, I kick you right in the rear end. That's the way I see it. So we ain't gonna play around with these two guys no more. It's got serious. We come out there.
Yeah, Rocker Rock's just now, saying whatever words come to his brain.
Johnny, it looked like you guys stopped playing some time ago with these guys.
Stagger Lee, if they think for 1 minute they're going to come in and
I love how Paul Heyman convinced people that this guy was like a thug from Philly that like mugged people on the streets.
They got
hey, yo!
Because they're going to fall right in a big
wildfire, Tyler Ridge! You're going to beat your ass!
Too much. Alex Wright, you definitely been hitting the head too much. And if you think Flyboy Rocko Rock and Johnny Grunge
are going to lay out for you,
you better get ready for a rude awakening!
Guys, thanks very much for taking time to speak to me and speak to the fans. Fans, we've got a lot more action coming
look
up
look how,
for
like,
you.
Smothered Lee Marshall is
Saturday
in there.
Continues whatever you do.
Thank you.
Go away.
Well, tonight, back after this. I'm stuck between these two men.
And I find out
yeah, that's a good point, Brian. Rocco just breaks character the second he's done talking. And he's still on camera for another minute.
WCW Saturday Night and the dissension that reigns within NWO Hollywood, Mike Tenay, for my money, that began at the Georgia Dome when Scott Hall dropped the ball.
I've never seen such
yeah, Rocker Rock promos, like he's trying to imitate like seven different dudes he's met on the streets.
Finger pointing from Hollywood Hogan. It seems that he squarely placed the blame on Scott Hall for Hogan's.
Man, imagine if Rocco cut that promo on Oddville.
Monday and take another look at Hollywood Hogan against Scott Hall, and I can guarantee you, you are not going to believe
Mike Tenay
the conclusion of this matchup.
Hosts
Hogan
wrestling
gave NWO
like
a gut check.
The first kid in third grade
to Hollywood Hogan. Hollywood
who
Hogan
got
to
see boobs like in a magazine. You guys get this. Women grow hair down here. Also, you will not believe what Hulk Hogan said on Nitro this week.
And all ears. And if it wasn't for you, Scott Hall, I wouldn't be in.
Look at Rick Rude trying to look like the baddest ass dude. Look, he doesn't need much help. But like, he's clearly trying to like stand out. Like, he's in training.
I would still have my belt. And oh yeah, brother, I've heard the crap, and I've heard your rap in the back.
Hogan's tan is ridiculous. Like, it was always ridiculous. But, it looks problematic. Standing next to Vincent.
What you're made of, and how loyal you are to the cause. I'm calling you out tonight.
Like, Scott Hall used to pretend to be Latino, and somehow that is way less offensive than whatever's going on with Hulk Hogan's skin here.
I wax ass with the belt like you told me to. I've done everything you said because, honestly, I need the money.
If you go back and read the Wrestling Observers at this point, like, Hogan and Nash, the reason why they don't, like, really do a lot on screen from this point, like, you think Hollywood and the Wolfpack would, like, be bashing a lot. You get, like, Hogan-Nash matches, right? No, they hated each other. So this was essentially Eric Bischoff's answer to a situation like the Young Bucks CM Punk stuff going on right now. He just put them in separate groups. And, like, the underneath guys in those groups would wrestle, but Hogan and Nash are kept apart. Like, it's just funny, the parallels. Here comes DDP in his vinyl jeans. Oh, he just pushed Ed Leslie down.
From behind now on DDP.
Somehow Disciple's a little more brown than Hogan. Hogan say rap and crap, and he's like, you're on to something. It's always fun looking back at these old shows and seeing who's wearing their video game gear. Like, yeah, that's the NWO, the WCW NWO revenge gear. Is he strangling him? Is he really? I think Hogan might have taken it when they did the 99 feud after him and Nash made up. They did that weird feud where Hogan went back to the red and yellow. I think he might have taken it there, but he did not take it when during this run.
Between Hollywood Hogan and Scott Hall, after Scott Hall, we thought had reached the
Oh, it's Jim Powers, I believe.
Once again,
hell yeah.
Back on his best friend Kevin Nash and re-ups with NWO Hollywood.
Hollywood Hogan loves to spread the blame. Even went so far as to point the finger at Scott Hall for his losing.
I love how Jim Powers, every Jim Powers entrance, if you go on YouTube and watch Jim Powers matches in WCW, he would ignore the crowd and just do this for like 3/4 of the way. And then right at the end, he'd be like, shit, I have to be a babyface, and just slap the hell out of like 3 or 4 fans right there's hands, and then run in the ring. Young up-and-comer Jim Powers. Against, hell yeah, Barry Darsow. Get that stinking camera out of my face.
I'm not looking forward to running into Hollywood Hogan again. I don't know what the guy's capable of.
Scott, I hate to even
the uncle of professional wrestling, Barry Darsow. I love that book, Dan.
Break
your stinking
arm.
We need more fans to do that for wrestlers.
Confined to a wheelchair temporarily as he goes through rehab following the injury he suffered a couple of months
I
ago.
I love how the soundtrack very, very well. To a woman going Bagwell, to Barry Darsow is Scott Hudson being like, you know, Buff Bagwell, he's in a wheelchair. He can't walk right now. I never walk again.
We don't even know what Buff had in store for Rick Steiner.
Warrior would be in 2 months or about a month and a half after this.
Buff Bagwell out of the wheelchair onto the arena floor. It's not worth repeating. And Hollywood Hogan,
I'm sure Hogan took a powerbomb from Mike Awesome in 2000.
We are not going to show that footage on WCW Saturday.
I know he gave Mike Awesome a Hurricane Rana. I will never forget the Hulk Hogan Hurricane Rana for as long as I live. It was something.
This young man is a fighter. Think about it. Twice he was near death because of complications
mouth.
From that neck surgery.
Barry Darsow should have been in the black
to come out and interfere. Let's just
like they should have just why not?
It's Barry Darsow and Jim Powers next up on Saturday night. Darsow missed the clothesline. Powers high cross body covers and he got the two count on Big Barry.
Big Barry.
Expect this to be power versus power. Strength of these both men. I don't think we're going to see too many high risk moves from either Jim Powers or Barry.
Good observation, McKinney. We're not going to see too many high-risk moves in a Barry Darsow match. What's Barry going to do here? He's sneaking up like Repo Man. He's doing some Repo Man stuff here.
All
right.
The meat hook from Barry Darsow.
The meat hook.
Very experienced competitors inside the square circle. And Barry Darsow having something to say to the fans here at ringside.
I love Barry Darsow. What's great about Barry Darsow is he can do this exact match today. He's like in his 70s, I'm pretty sure.
Tickets available at the Alamo Dome box office and Ticketmaster.
He's like 40 something. He's at least mid 60s. Either way, he's a senior citizen and he could do this exact match.
It's Monday Nitro in Rapid City, South Dakota. Tickets available at the Rushmore Plaza.
He just hung them. Like that was what that move was.
On Omaha Street in Rapid City.
And let's not forget also at 8:05 tonight, right here on the Superstation TBS Live. From the
What's
Big
he
Apple,
do here?
New York City, the opening celebration.
Oh, he's gonna bend his arm the correct way. Always love a good hold where a wrestler's arm is bent a little right. He didn't even bend the arm, he just held it. He just held it up in the air. I love that. This guy's I love Barry Darsow. He's the best. Gonna bend the arm the right way.
Sergey Bubka. You talk about wrestling, you're gonna see Les Gutches, the 1997 world champion, as well as Kerry Colak, the 97 world silver medalist, facing the
Russians. Yeah, drugs you miss. Miss some stuff. But you woke up just in time for Barry Darsow. You're back just in time.
Nothing very celebratory about Barry Darsow as he's thinking,
oh, boy. I love Barry Darsow. I love that he made six figures to essentially do an indie match every night. Not like a current indie match where you have to try hard, but like a 90s indie match where you just stand there and yell at people for 10 minutes. He made Nick Patrick's hair move.
Decibel for decibel, and the fans having something to say to Barry Darsow, and I don't blame him.
Barry Darsow carries on that running monologue all throughout his matches, whether he's bad-mouthing, trash-talking his opponents, the referee, or even the fans at ringside.
We talk about power versus power here, and Jim Power is obviously a very powerful young man. Darsow has deceptive power, and no, I don't mean he's weaker than he looks. He is a very strong man inside that ring. He's got a very strong mouth, too. You can hear him all the way
up. Very strong mouth.
Both very experienced competitors.
Oh, that young up-and-comer using his speed.
Got the inside cradle, and Darsow kicked out at two. That might have just
I love how Darsow doesn't even try to, like, do anything to cut him off. He just grabs him.
Right in the chest.
Like, nope, right back to the heat, buddy. Yeah, it was fun when Barry Darsow did that thing where he was, I'm crushing her stuff this week. I love that even as low down the totem pole as Barry Darsow was, WWE threatened to sue if he did Demolition X or Repo Man on WCW Worldwide.
That took Darsow off his feet. Let's see what Power's follow-up move is.
Shoots him across, waits on him, drop kick on Barry.
I'm gonna pick the camera angle that shows that Jim Power's foot came nowhere near him.
I think Power's just caught him with one foot on that drop kick.
Darsow doesn't even bother selling what just happened.
Darsow off balance.
Powers sets him up, shoots him into the corner, charges, and it's Darsow out of the way, and he hit the pole.
Oh, what a mistake that is for Jim Powers. And look at Darsow from behind.
Watch out, Jim. Oh, right in the gut.
Good gut punch.
That one doubled him over. Out of the hammerlock.
Oh, jeez, Barry Darsow.
The setup for the barely legal. And there we go.
Yeah, we were talking about it a little bit ago, Pep, the Hulk Hogan puppet. It's very funny. There we go, the barely legal.
Submission victory for Barry Darsow.
Because, you know, when I think of the phrase barely legal, I think of Barry Darsow.
Barry Darsow gains the win right here on WCW Saturday Night.
Oh yeah, drugs. Make them smell you. Hey, it's from Barry Darsow straight to Shima.
Nobunaga against the teacher, the Ultimo Dragon. Scott, we've talked
about
this in the past. Ultimo Dragon, who resides in Mexico City, has his own wrestling school, an arena now called upon.
Like this, this is what I love about WCW.
Ultimo Dragon,
is you can have Barry Darsow doing some uncle bullshit. Right into Shima against Ultimo Dragon.
Him, believe it or not good enough to make the cut.
I hate to sound like an old man doing a podcast. This is what wrestling is missing these days.
That the wrestling organizations in Japan demanded his return.
Some real
there are so many youngsters who are going
bullshit. Some fun bullshit, but some real bullshit. And then, like, two of the most athletic, talented, young junior heavyweights in the world. Dude, if I am ever able to, like, get this thing going to where, like, I can sell shirts, some uncle bullshit will be the first one.
And you go to the Greg Maddux baseball camp, you're going to be a good pitcher when you come out. If you're a Tony Lee quarterback and you go to the John Elway quarterback camp,
we're comparing Ultimo Dragon to Greg Maddux.
Dude,
we do not have
Dojo
enough uncles. I feel like, I think the Butcher from AEW is like the only uncle in wrestling right now.
By Ultimo Dragon.
I think they are certainly the future of the WCW Cruiserweight division, as well as
Ultimo Dragon wearing a pat on the elbow that a surgeon would suit Butcher. That would put him on the shelf for like years. JD Drake is, I'd say, a 0.9 on the uncle scale.
Into an ankle lock on Ultimo Dragon by Nobunaga.
You know, we've been talking about the goodwill game.
I don't think Sandre's an uncle. He's got a lot of youth too.
Coming up tonight, right after the conclusion even
in his current age.
And as a result, for the next couple of weeks, we're not going to
gray hair Keith Lee is
daddy. On the Superstation. But Thunder
that is 100%
on
daddy
Wednesday,
right there.
August the 5th in Casper, Wyoming.
Look at this.
And tickets are available at the Casper.
What is the old Joey Styles thing?
Mr.
Salty?
Into Fargo, North Dakota on Thursday, August the 13th. Tickets at the Fargo Dome.
I am not looking forward to the Kevin Sullivan podcast because like 10 years ago, I listened to some of his podcasts he did with the MSL dude, and he doesn't remember anything that he did, but he pretends like he does, and it's so much
bullshit.
What an amazing sequence we just saw that ended in the Hurricane Rana cradle by Ultimo Dragon, and look at Dragon, the drop kick out of the headstand, and just
man, if Nigel McGuinness doesn't come back to wrestling,
other corner, and Nobunaga
even part time,
right.
Somebody needs to bring back the headstand.
Now shoulders high. Hurricane Rana cradles it. Two. And he got the two count on Nobunaga.
I've never heard this incident we're speaking of, Baron Bonarashi, but I'm not surprised that Kevin Sullivan took a piss during a podcast
right
once.
You talk about that world cruiserweight title held by Chris Jericho.
Ooh.
Dragon has to be considered one of the top contenders, along with Rey Mysterio Jr., Juventud Guerrera, Dean Malenko especially. The cruiserweight rank.
Jim's pants
kind
of look like the doorway of any family video porno room.
Nobunaga, springboard to the outside.
Oh.
Spring into the inside.
With those tassels hanging down.
Yeah, just diving headbutt from Nobunaga gets a two count.
They break the mold down at Ultimo Dragon's dojo in Mexico City, stuff we've never seen before.
Ooh.
Spin kick on Ultimo Dragon by Nobunaga. Quickly over. Lateral press, hooks the leg at the two count. on his professor.
Did Kevin Nash could, I think he's earned the right to take a piss wherever and whenever he
familiar with each other. The wrestler in this matchup that is going to be able to vary his offensive maneuvers or moves like the experienced Ultimo Dragon probably is going to be the man who comes out victorious.
I love the story. I forget who it was. One of the ECW guys told them they were walking through Japan with Terry Funk after a show years ago. And, like, it's nighttime, but it's not, like, super late. Like, there are people around. And Terry Funk just whips himself out and takes a piss in a trash can while people are walking by. And whoever this was like, what are you doing? And Terry's like, I'm the Funker. I'm allowed to do this. And yeah, sure enough, nothing happened to him. Nobody batted an eye.
Out of the step over armbar, and Dragon rolls him up, hooks the leg. He got the two and he almost got the three. Wow, what back and forth action.
The Dudleys, okay.
Neither man can get that.
Thank you, Sega.
Out, each got a
I knew it was somebody from ECW.
Pass, both going for the vertical suplex. Up and over, attempted the German standing switch. Back elbow by Dragon. Oh, the drop toe hold by Nobunaga.
Look at this. Nobunaga
roll up. Hooks the leg, he got the two on Ultimo Dragon.
How about that? He tried to beat Dragon with one of his own patented moves, the Mahi
Strong. Dude, going back and watching like footage of American wrestlers in Japan in like the 70s and 80s.
Wow.
Terry Funk could pee on, like, not in like a sexual way, just like a, there's nowhere else to pee, and I wouldn't take it. I'm being all right. There we go. Oh.
Nicely executed after the cartwheel. Sets up Nobunaga on the top rope.
And time to do a gym face from the office into the camera.
Nobunaga stunned enough for this one. Dragon way up in the rafters. Oh, the Hurricanrana from the top rope.
Frankensteinered him back into the ring. Looks to the crowd. There it is. Dragon sleeper applied.
I love how the next dude to do this as a finish in America after the Ultimo Dragon was the Undertaker. Like, I would love to sit with The Undertaker and watch Ultimo Dragon.
The experience factor wins out.
Who wants did a lot of things, including taking the piss off of CNN Tower. Harry Punk can pee on me. That is a good episode title. Up next, the main event of a recently clean Sick Boy against Barry Saturn.
This past Thursday on WCW Thunder, the Iceman, Dean Malenko, made a call out to AA, the enforcer, Arn Anderson, and Malenko had some questions about the Four Horsemen.
Arn Anderson, I know in some capacity.
Dude, Sick Boy. I love that Sick Boy was going to be the end product, I guess. His debut in WWE was going to be the end result of that Kane Katie Vick thing. That's why her name was Katie Vick. Because Scott Vick, aka Sick Boy, was going to be her brother who would come in and beat up Kane for killing and assaulting his dead sister.
At that time, I was working for New Japan Pro Wrestling. You had come over on a 3-week tour. And at that time, we had the opportunity to sit down man to man and get to know each other a little bit. Get to know each other about each other's families, about our careers.
Pissing some trash cans.
The conclusion I came up during those meetings was they had one common denominator between both of us. And that was our worth ethic, our pride, our
desire,
our determination that we took each and every time we stepped right here in this ring. Arn, if you look deep enough, you'll find one person. And you, my friend, still believe in this.
Crapple is a dude.
Let me tell you what it
look at Mongo's shirt. Mongo is wearing Sick Boy's, like, in-ring tight shirt. Just as, like, a shirt to wear out in public.
You just don't want to wrestle anymore.
And he's, like, 40-something at this point.
So don't presume you can stick four fingers in my face and get my attention, because you ain't earned the right.
Don't presume you can stick four fingers in my face and get my attention. Why is Arn's shirt off?
Every time one of you go through that curtain,
They should have left in the part where he got emotional enough to take the shirt off. As is, it just looked like he took his shirt off just that fun.
Any humanity left in your body, just let it be.
Again, why is Arn's shirt off?
For the next 2 weeks on the Superstation, it's the Goodwill Games, and because of the Superstation's
the Goodwill Games
of the Goodwill Games from New York, Thunder will be preempted, but we will return to the airwaves live on August the 5th from Casper, Wyoming.
Hell yeah, Casper, Wyoming. In all the big towns.
As well as the NWO Hollywood organization.
Like, I don't know if he was horny. He seemed mad, but he could have been horny. Could have been warm. We don't know why his shirt was off. Now we have a mystery.
And the next chapter will be written here tonight.
There's Texas and Wyoming.
On WCW Casper. Saturday night, making his way.
What if Arn had a hot flash?
Saturn, at one time a Flock member, if you will, a
Perry Saturn
founder with Raven when they left the land of barbed wire and made their way to
the land of barbed wire. You Saturn punk
was the first to leave on his own free will and volition, Mike. And
I love all of the different phrasings they would use in WCW. They would not say in WCW.
To Saturn is history. Main event is next.
Arn was 28. Arn was like 36 when he retired.
And Saturn waits in the ring for his
like a year before this. So he was like 37.
Saturday night, there is the ever-present Lodi and Sickboy.
As Gina Perlin would have told us the truth about ECW.
Saturday night. You know, the situation involving Saturn and Raven has evolved into a three-way rivalry with the presence of Canyon. And you sit back and you look at that overall situation, Scott, and I almost see it as Raven's master plan taking effect.
What is...
He's trying to divert the attention.
Is he doing like an Ash Wednesday spoof? Look at the thing on Lodi's forehead.
Canyon have lost sight of the true enemy in this war, and of course that true enemy is Raven.
Collar and elbow tie-up. Saturn and Sick Boy on Saturday night.
Oh, Lodi.
Whoa, a push out by Saturn and Lodi grabbing the ankle of Saturn. Nice distraction as Sick Boy follows through. Reversal by
Pop
Saturn.
Quiz. That was a dope back elbow. That should have been his pop quiz, Brian. You should have been pitching more names when you were backstage at TNA.
Saturn should not be surprised by any outside interference from Lodi, that's for sure.
Certainly not. He benefited from it at
one point. Yeah. Sick Boy's gear looks like the top of a wetsuit. And then, like, Daisy Dukes.
Only in his own mind.
But they're not quite sure enough.
This is another example of the talent within the Flock.
People back in the in this era thought Sick Boy was going to be the breakout guy in the Flock. Because he was like 6'2 or whatever, and he had a body, and he could do springboards, and he looked good.
That's all part of Raven's plan. Of course, Raven has accomplished quite a bit in bringing that.
Ryan, hopefully your storyline didn't end with Mickey. Eventually realizing she was not in love with the rope guy, and the rope guy pushes her into a subway train track.
High kick to the side of the head of Sick Boy.
Hopefully that's not how.
And Sick Boy in a bad way in the corner. Now Lodi at ringside. I got to keep an eye on that guy.
Yeah, you notice as soon as Saturn was finished unleashing his offensive attack on Sick Boy, he turned and circled around the ring. He was looking for Lodi at ringside. But Lodi's hooked onto the belt.
Oh! Saturn going for the top rope suplex. Lodi held on, and Sick Boy caught him with a nice clothesline.
Lodi, who apparently recently had a heart attack in a match on an indie show, and kept wrestling for a bit, and then drove home and was like, that was weird what happened with my chest, and then went to the doctor, and they realized, oh no, you had a heart attack in the ring.
Lateral press got the two count on Saturn.
There is just so much fight left in Saturn.
Yeah, that was wild.
We talked about his history through the years, the fact that he was a part of the Army Rangers, over 100 jumps to his credit. Not a man that's going to be...
I love how... Okay, so they would always say... They would always credit Perry Saturn having all these, like, big jumps as an Army Ranger. But the way they made it sound, he was just jumping out of airplanes for fun.
But I didn't see Raven.
Like, there was no point to it. It's just he would just go out on a Wednesday and jump out of an airplane. I love a way for our government to spend money. Oh, almost in death. Oh, and you're ever. Oh, it's an F5.
Thought he may be going for the DVD. Had him up in the fireman's carry. Dropped him down almost to move.
Brock Lesnar's got nothing on Sick Boy.
Canyon, that innovator of offense. Oh, yeah. He'll take you up into any number of moves, albeit the fireman's carry or whatever it is that he decides, and then who knows where he's going from there. Small package.
The inside cradle by Saturn got the two count on Sick Boy.
High knee from Sick Boy.
Jumping knee.
Whoa, look at the look on Saturn's face. He felt that one.
Nice move by Sick Boy.
Sick Boy's finish was a pedigree. I think he only got to do it like once in a match ever, but yes. Sick Boy's finisher was a pedigree, and I remember that because that was his finisher in WCW and WO Revenge.
Covers it quickly, too, and he got the two count on Saturn.
Landed him in the middle of the ring.
What is diseased guy doing in the Impact Zone? I love it, Pepper. Diseased guy.
You just can't beat Saturn that quickly, but this may do it. A series of right hands by Sick Boy on Saturn. Opens up the former member of the Flock. Hang on, reversal by Saturn. Another reversal and into the corner.
Oh, why did he run into him?
He reversed the reversal.
What happened?
I think their heads bumped together.
Saturn and Sick Boy both felt that one. Sick Boy managed to hang on to the top rope and stay vertical.
I'm so confused.
Saturn on his knees in the center of the ring. This may help Sick Boy. Follows up. Elbow, forearm to the side of the head of Saturn. There's a right hand on Saturn. And Sick Boy now dropped Saturn in the center of the ring to cover. Lateral press and he got the two.
Scott, I think we need to point out...
Sick Boy's kind of dressed like how Stephanie McMahon would.
We will show history in
when
the making.
With Triple H turn that first run. In like 99.
What a night it was at the Georgia Dome. You can relive it at the conclusion of this great contest. Goldberg defeats Hollywood Hogan. You want to see it one more time? You got it. Just hang on. Saturn, go by.
Ooh, alright. Okay, he didn't double on his head like he cut off.
Double underhook. Tiger suplex that time by Saturn. Let's see if he can follow up the advantage.
Grabs a handful of hair. Hang on.
There we go. Death Valley Driver. Ooh, that's it.
Dropped him on his head. He spiked him. He got him.
What's the leg in
the Alright. Perry Saturn has won the main event with both the show. Oh, here comes Horace.
We knew there were other Flock members.
That jerk. How dare he? Just worked a double at Hulk's Bar and Grill. Got burned by the grill itself. What the hell was that?
Ooh.
Unless their hearts were actually doing like storyline stuff on WCW Saturday Night.
This is terrible.
He's gamely trying to fight back.
I guess we should have.
Yeah, everybody, like, they just went to Walmart, bought a bunch of pairs of black jeans, and then somebody ran around button and strutting, baby.
And Raven has Saturn where he wants it. Let's get out of this. Let's go back to the Georgia Dome on Nitro. Goldberg and Hollywood Hogan.
This match.
Yeah, no offense to Hulk Hogan, but we've all seen it. And if you haven't, it's on Peacock. Hulk Hogan, like blah, 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 and then Goldberg beats him for the world title. That's it for this week. I'm sorry I kept you about 5 minutes after the top of the hour, but I appreciate you all staying up a little late this week. That'll be Brian. DDDYKI, Pep Bender, Jonathan Mayer, Nathan LJH, Salmon, Brian Germany, all the folks in the chat. Thank you all so much for another great Tuesday night inside of Mike Tenay's little tent with his luchadors. Thank you, Adam. Thank you, 6969 and on. Next week, again, we're going back to the year 1992, WCW Power Hour. Thank you, Henry. So yeah, next week, 1992, the beginning of the Bill Watts era of WCW. It'll be something. So thank you all so much once again. Thank you, Suzanne.
We will see you all next Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern on the dot. This is WCW Deep Cuts Live. My name's Tom. My socials are here. I didn't do the finger thing this week. We're out of time. Have a good week. Let's come back next week. One piece. All of us. It'll probably be hard, but we'll come back here and for 2 hours, we'll forget about everything else. It'll just be us watching some wrestling. So, good night. Take care. You are loved. We'll see you next week.